I'd like to introduce is the Doctor, Mr. Jon Pertwee.
One is that I don't know the answers to half of them. My memory isn't that good. And second, it's more fun if we sort of spread the questions out a bit and we talk about all kinds of things, you know, our likes and loves and our animals and our babies and our grandfathers and whatever. And then where we all started and where you all finished and so on. So that's it, and we're now sort of open, and perhaps we'd like to, wait a minute, before we sort of start the questions, I think it might be a good idea if I handed over to Louise and got her to tell you her name and where she comes from and how she got into the theatre, because I'm sure you like to know things like that and people don't often think of asking them. Would you feel inclined to answer the question of that nature?
I feel vaguely inclined, yes. Right. My name is Louise Jameson. Thank you! What I would like to say about these... can you put your hands up if you were here yesterday? Oh, I didn't want to bore you with the same opening spiel. Okay, well when...
Yes.
All right, I'm going to anyway, all right. When I first came over to America, my plane was 9 hours late taking off. So I actually took off 2 hours after I was supposed to land. When I arrived, nobody was there to meet me. This is for my first convention in California. Nobody there to meet me, and I panicked. And what do you do in a panic situation? Go on, tell me.
Scream.
No. Not Leela.
No.
Okay, what did... Phone home, right? So I called the operator and dialed and said, excuse me, do you think I could make a transfer charge, call home to London? Long pause, and this voice went, oh, what? I said, would it be at all possible to make a transfer charge, call home to... What's that? I said, it's when the other person pays for the call. Oh, you mean call collect, why didn't you say so? So I eventually got home and organised it all. This is rather a long-winded way of saying that even though we speak the same language, there is still a language barrier. I have another short story to indicate this, which is in indoor tennis court in New York. I'm one side of the room, and the male that I'm playing with is the other side of the room, and I'm just going off to the restroom before we play, and I called out to him, oh, we'll knock up before we start, okay? The whole place comes to a start. I think, oh my, what have I said? Oh, it was explained to me later what I'd said. died. And one other short story which I heard yesterday, apparently JMT, on his first convention, really down south somewhere, was somebody put their hand up and said, "Miss JMT, you got a gant regular?" He said, "What? You got a regular?" I had no idea what the person was asking. So even though we speak the same language, you have a language barrier, and I really believe Doctor Who has done something to join the two countries together. Yeah. Well, let's hope this kind of session will do so as well. Anything you want to know about the past? Well, almost anything you want to know about that. Please raise your hand and ask the questions. Otherwise, shall we just throw it open now and whatever they want to ask?
After I've done my opening.
Do your opening spiel. Of course you have.
Yeah, I have an experience that with it years ago. I was working in a play on Broadway called There's a Girl in My Soup, and which some of you may have seen the movie. I wasn't in the movie. We never are. If you're very good in the play, you're never in the film. Very interesting. And I went to stay the weekend with some friends who had a home on Long Island, and they took a boat and they went to Fire Island for a trip, for a picnic. And I turned around to a friend of mine, a young friend who was in the play, who was very heterosexual, actually, but he was very pretty. And I said to him, "Hey, go on, have you got the fags?" That on Fire Island got us off to a very, very bad start. We were followed for the rest of the day. My name is Jon Pertwee de Laillevaux. Yeah. Right. Right on, brother. Yeah. But of course, none of you could pronounce that name, or nobody in England could either. The name is Pertwee, P-E-R-T-H-U-I-S, small D-E, Laillevaux, L-A-I-L-L-A-V-A-U-L-T. We're French, I'm a Huguenot, I escaped out of France, at least I didn't, but people earlier than me. I'm fairly old, I'm not that old, AKA 1687, and... there was one fellow called Georges Pertwee de Laillevaux, and he was the only Protestant in the family of Pertwee de Laillevaux. Who were all Catholics, who were all royalists and members of the court, but he was the only one that escaped into England, and all the vast clan of Pertwees in England now stemmed from his loins. Good old George, what a great character. And however, the family still keep together, and my family name was changed to Pertwee. Because nobody could pronounce the name Pertwee. They all called me Pertwis. And so it was changed to Pertwee, and now they call us Pee-wee, Pee-wit, Partley, Partridge. And once, when I was working in, as I've mentioned in my book, that I was working in this play on Broadway, and the stage doorkeeper, one day after I'd been there for 6 months, said, "Hey, Jan!" And I paid no attention because my name is not Jan, as you by now know. And I paid no attention, and I went on walking. He said, "Hey, Jan!" And I turned and said, "Who?" He said, "Yeah, Jan Putrid, a letter for you." So, ladies and gentlemen, sitting before you is Jan Putrid. Of old theatrical background. My father was Roland Putrid. He was a playwright and worked in Hollywood a great deal of his life, writing early movies for people like Leslie Howard and the great sort of English stars, Ronald Colman and so on. And I started in the theatre as a straight actor, but was fired from practically everything. From the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art, I was fired because I didn't want to be a wind. I said, didn't want to be a wind. I was sacked from that. And from most things, early repertory companies I was fired from, but eventually finished up doing light entertainment, variety, vaudeville, musical, cabaret, and then turned the full circle and went back to drama and television, and hence Doctor Who. But we'll pick it on from there. So let's now you know who we are, let's open it up for questions. There's a lady there. Yes, madam.
In American markets.
You hear the question, Lady Heard, that words will come, but you come in. Now, but hands up, those of you who don't know what on earth she's talking about and don't know what Wurzel Gummidge is. Right, I will tell you.
Wurzel Gummidge, he's a scarecrow, and he's a wicked old bugger, he is, isn't he? He
has no brains, he's made of twigs and straw, and he has two little young kids who can see him. He's alive to them, and he's a real person. And he's in love with an Aunt Sally, which is the thing you throw wooden balls at in fun fairs and in circuses and showgrounds. It's been a very great success in England as a television series, and we were peaking at about 11 million viewers a week when Southern Television, our television company, lost their franchise and they went out of business. And of course the new company that took over said they were going to take over Wurzel Gummidge, but they didn't because they found it too expensive. It's always a question of money, as all television is, the theatre. And so they didn't do it. So we've been waiting for 3 years to try to get a new production company together. And I'm happy to say that at last we've got one. And the New Zealand Film Finance Corporation and a producer called Graham McLean has raised the money. And we are now going to shoot a series of Wurzel in New Zealand. It's a strange place to go. But it's not going to be, we're not pretending that it's England, it's going to be New Zealand, because the show is all about the English countryside. Aunt Sally's always escaping. She is in love with the King of Bulgaria, she says. And she's always going off to America. She calls it America, she calls it America. And so she probably thinks that she's going to America and gets on the cattle boat and finishes up in New Zealand. That's probably what's going to happen. But when we've made that series of 10, that will mean that our numbers will be up to the numbers that television companies require here, because most of our shows, you know, are strip show, and they like to show them every day, so they want a minimum of 50 programs, and up till now we haven't got 50 programs. But in England it's coming back on the air in October, where it's going to be repeated for the next 3 years. Hooray for me. And then the new series will be brought in, and it'll work back to back, and by that time we hope that we'll be able to sell it to the United States. It's pretty silly that it hasn't been sold already, because hands up those of you that have seen it. Quite a number. Any of you have any problems understanding it?
No.
See, we're always told, I mean, I'm sure you've been told this over and over again, that the Americans don't understand English. Oh, you think that's funny. It's absolutely true. They really honestly say that we don't understand English, particularly you lot. Oh, yeah. You, madam. You all, down there. They say you can't understand English down in the South, and I say that's absolute rubbish. You understand Doctor Who, all right, so why the hell can't you understand
English? We can't understand ourselves. We understand English.
Well, and one of your most popular channels is Channel 13 and PBS, and you watch, what is it, 60%, I suppose, of British programmes on it, on a TV, yeah. So you obviously like the British programme. Yes, a question for Louise, please. Yes, sir.
Well, a question.
What do you have?
Pets.
Pets.
I have 2 goldfish. And I have 2 children. That's enough to keep anyone busy for a lifetime, I tell you.
Are your goldfish, are they sort of tame, or are they sort of wild?
They're very tame. They're very, very tame indeed. They're very beautiful. I did lose one.
What do you mean?
We had to flush it down the lavatory.
He got out. He went for a swim, you mean?
No, it didn't go for a swim. It just stopped. It just sank on the bottom and got these white globules all over it.
Oh, yes.
So we had a little funeral, and my 3-year-old son and I put it down the loo, and we went out and bought another one. And the next time the next one got ill, I did some faith healing on it. In fact, looking in the top of the bowl, it starts this, you know, normally a little quick movement, starts lying there going, blah. This poor thing's had it. Should we flush it down? I said, no, I'll give it some love. And I stood over the bowl and I poured love into the goldfish bowl, and the next morning it was all right. It was all right.
Isn't it? You didn't give it the kiss of life.
No.
It's very hard giving a goldfish the kiss of life.
Anyway, what are your... What pets do you have Mr.
Well,
Pritchard.
I've had a series of very, very strange pets. I like animals. My wife and I have a very nice dog who's a Cavalier Spaniel called, what the hell is his name? Digby, Lord Digby of Barnes. He's a snob. They're all terrible snobs. He wears a monocle if he'd have his way. I used to have a bush baby, which is the thing that sort of leaps around, you know, their eyes and leaps around at night. The only trouble is they will pee on their hands every time they jump anywhere, and they are inclined to leave little sort of putty paw marks all over the place. And he bit my wife's feet all the time. They don't like ladies' feet, bush babies. I love ladies' feet. But Bertie, his name was, didn't like ladies' feet. And then years ago, I did have a very interesting, then there was a man, who thought he'd start racing cheetahs in England instead of greyhounds. He thought, what a great idea to race cheetahs, fastest running animal in the world. So we went to Stamford Bridge for the opening, and they had these four cheetahs, you know, put in the trap, and they let the hair go. You've seen greyhound racing, haven't you? And they have an electric hair which sort of shoots off just a sort of skin around a bullet on the end of a rail. And it went, when it was about as far as the end of this room, they opened the trap and the cheetahs went out and they ate the whole rabbit before it had gone about as far as that, you see. And they thought, well, that wasn't very good, or the bookmakers were not best pleased at all. They had to give all the money back, and so they said, right, we'll have the next race. And the next race, they let the rabbit go, and the rabbit went round to about here, you see. So the cheetahs, they're no fools, cheetahs. They opened the trap and the cheetahs went, oh, he's over there, and went, sure. And they ate the rabbit again. The third time, they didn't even bother. They sat and waited for it to come round at that one. So, this was rather a disaster. So the fellow who owned all these cheetahs said, I've got to get rid of these cheetahs. So he said, would you like to have one? Now, when you're a young blade around London, you know, you've read about the great American boxer, you know, Jack Johnson, who used to go around with a cheetah on a leopard on the end of a chain, and what was the name of the famous French, the black lady singer in Paris? Josephine Baker, indeed. I mean, she was always walking in the Champs-Élysées with a leopard, and I really fancied myself, you know, tight blue jeans and a t-shirt, walking along with a cheetah on a chain. So he gave me this cheetah. It was a lovely, it was a beautiful animal, and I used to take it out for walks on Wimbledon Common. They were for runs, really, because it used to run very fast. They run at 75 mile an hour, and I can't run 75 mile an hour. And so I used to let it chase swallows, which were low on the ground, and off it would go chasing swallows, and it did a beautiful dive one day, and it went over the hedge, and it landed in the middle of a picnic. And there was a very elderly lady there, about 173, and a lot of kids, and all the pies and puddings and sandwiches were all out there. And people said, "Ah, bloody leopard!" And the old lady had the vapors that had been taken off to Wimbledon Hospital. And the jam tart was all over the place, and the poor cheetah, you know, was stuck with mince pies, and the whole thing was a terrible. And so I was arrested for causing a breach of the peace. And so the cheetah duly went back, as he quite rightly should, to his own land of Kenya, where he ran free, like the famous Elsa. Right, next question. Yes, sir.
I'd like to ask a two-part question. What's next in both of your careers, and who do you both consider your mentors, your talent notwithstanding your own background?
But nice question.
Okay, I'm in the middle of recording a series called Bergerac, which I believe is shown on PBS, and some fans from North Carolina have seen it. My actual episodes haven't come out yet, so that's me filming through till October. I've got a couple more conventions lined up. Hopefully I'm going to get some work in LA. I got myself an agent last week, so things are underway there. So I'd like to come back for a month and just try and work over here for at least a year. I'd really love to. I feel the country's welcomed me, mainly through you lot, so much that I just feel at home here, comfortable here. I'd like to work here. Thank you. Now, as far as mentors goes, that's quite difficult because we all strive to be unique in some way, shape, or form. And I wouldn't like to say I've modeled myself on anyone. I just strive to be myself, which is difficult enough without trying to be somebody else. I admire most Vanessa Redgrave and Judi Dench as actresses. I just think their truth and their, just their ability to be so vulnerable is just admirable. I can't take my eyes off them, either of them, when I see them on film.
I have to go back to go to New Zealand, as I told you, to shoot Wurzel Gummidge. I was going to go with my wife, Nicholas Courtney. We were going to Wisconsin and Milwaukee for their, to what they call the Dairy Con. And then we were going down to St. Louis. And then I was going to Utex in Texas. I'm so sorry. And this, I'm afraid, has had to be cancelled. So if any of you here, that there's got to be a conference that I'm going to be present at, the answer is I can't be. Excuse me, I've got a bit of laryngitis. My mentor is the great Sir Laurence Olivier. He, I think, is the greatest living actor in the world. And I will give you an example of why I think he is. I was brought up with Sir Laurence because he married my cousin. His first wife was a lady called Jill Esmond. And we lived in a lovely house in Chelsea. When I was a student, I used to live with him in London. And so we were very close. And we've been very close ever since. And when he goes to parties, which is very rare, he doesn't like people touching him. Certainly not from the back. He doesn't mind people touching him from the front, so I can go out and I can say, hello, you see, how are you? I mean, that's all right. But if anybody goes in the back, he gets paranoid. And we went to this party after a show, and an elderly lady rushed up to him, and she clapped her hands over his eyes, and she said, guess who? And he leapt up, and he threw his arms up, and he threw this old lady arse over tits, right over the back of a settee, where she lay with her legs up in the air. Because the settee was right behind. It didn't hurt her, but I mean, she just went and fell with her legs stick up. And this is to prove that Laurence Olivier is the greatest actor in the world. He rushed up to his host and he said, who is that old woman? And he said, oh, that's my mother-in-law. He said, isn't she marvelous? I said, is a little difficult. Actors do not say things about other actors because it's frightfully silly, because if I say what I really think of Louise Jameson, the chances are that tomorrow we will be both cast in the same play and somebody's going to come up and say, did you know what Jon Pertwee said about you? She said, the bastard didn't, did he? Wait till I see him, and before you know where we are, we're spitting blood at each other, and I never said it at all, you see. So it's a very, very unwise thing ever to give any opinions about other people's work or so on, because it's very bad. So we keep shtum about that sort of thing. But you all know, to a degree, that Tom wasn't keen to work in The Five Doctors. He has his own theories about how Doctor Who should be played. He wanted to play it his own way, and he didn't want to be involved in a thing with The Five Doctors. Well, everybody else thought it was a good idea that everybody should be in it, as it was the birthday celebration. So we asked him, or John Nathan Turner, it did nothing to do with me, I'm just repeating what happened. John Nathan Turner asked him to come to the photographic session, the publicity session for the Doctors. Of course, poor Bill Hartnell couldn't come, he passed on. And so, I mean, he could have come, actually, you'd have enjoyed it. But, and so they got his double, who was Richard Hurdle, who sadly also passed on immediately after he'd done it. Obviously, it was a very strenuous role. But Richard was wonderful. He looked exactly like Bill. But it's a great tragedy. However, we all posed, and suddenly there was a big van arrived, and out of the van came Tom Baker. Did you not know this? Did you know? Oh, I can tell you some funny stuff. Anyway, and out of the back of the van came Tom Baker. And he was all in his hat and his cloak and his scarf and everything. And so we put him. Have you ever seen the photograph of us all? Well, you know when Tom's like that. They lent him up against me. And apart from his face looking a little waxy, that's how we got away with the photograph. And then, of course, as you know, when you saw the show, John Nathan Turner said, "Well, I'm going to put a bit of him in anyway." So Tom had made a series they'd never completed. Were you in that? Lala and Shada, that's right. And so they put a bit of Shada in it. So Tom didn't exactly have his own way. He was in it, whether he liked it or not. He was in the film, and we had a photograph taken with a wax dummy. And that's how it happened. Yes, sir.
How did I feel about not being invited to do the Five Doctors? Well, I felt a little left out, really.
I thought you were invited to be the Five Doctors.
No, I was invited to go back into the series to overlap Tom's leaving, because they wanted to be loyal. The loyal fans should have had somebody that they knew and recognised to do the overlap. And I said I'd go back in for one story, but I wouldn't go back in for a whole season.
Oh, yes, but of course the reason would be because you were always working with Tom, and as Tom wasn't in the series, I suppose they couldn't find
a way. I guess, because Mary Tan wasn't asked either, and she was Tom's assistant. But
they had
left me on Gallifrey, you see. I was written out on Gallifrey.
Ah.
Having my football team of kids, I think. So, but I felt hurt. Ask John Nathan Turner. I don't know why I wasn't asked. Question down the back, yeah? Down. Yeah.
This is for Louise Jameson. We have seen a series over here called The Mega Factor, which ran for 10 episodes here, and at the end of the 10th episode, it was like the very middle of the show. Can you elaborate on what happened?
Right, the one where I got to play the Doctor, right? Yes. Dr. Anne Reynolds. What happened at the end of that is every writer wants a 10-episode story to go on and on and on. The BBC only have a book for 10 episodes, and then they hum and haw about whether it's going to go on or not. So that nearly always a 10-episode story is not worth doing, because it's always left completely open-ended, because the BBC never make decisions at the right time. They always make them 6 months later. So it was never decided what happened. I mean, in my own mind, Anne Reynolds is an independent, money-earning, emotionally independent woman who just went on with her own life, really, who couldn't move down to London with Tom. But I'm sorry that it never got any further. It sort of sank without trace in England. We only had a 2.5 million viewing, I think, by the end of that particular episode. So I can't tell you what happened. It's up to your imagination.
John, you had mentioned in Atlanta last year that you wanted to work on the new Twilight Zone.
It's Colin.
Did
what the hell are you doing there, Colin?
Doctor, whether you like it or not.
Is always like a lovely Christmas tree. Yes, your question.
You had mentioned, Atlanta, that you wanted to work on the new Twilight Zone. Mm-hmm. Has anything come up with that? Are you going to be working after you finish Wars of Gummidge?
Well, that all happened because Rick Meyer was at Atlanta, if you remember. And Rick Meyer is something to do with the production of the new Twilight Zone series. And he had a specific story which he thought I'd be right for, and he sent me a book involving the story, and I read it and I liked it, but I haven't heard any more about it. But that's the norm. That's what normally happens. I mean, Rick may have thought it was a good idea and the director didn't.
Do you know what the status of the doctor right now? Do you know, like, they just did one with Patrick Troughton.
The lady's asking whether there's any plans for teaming up other doctors with the doctor, with Colin, because Patrick Troughton has just done two doctors, and we've already did a three doctors years ago, which some of you may have seen. And we did the five doctors with the plastic dummy from Madame Tussauds. As far as the future is concerned, of course, the whole future of Doctor Who is so much in the balance. I mean, nobody knows really what on earth's going on. I certainly don't, because I'm no longer connected with it. But if Colin was here, he'd probably tell you more than I can. But as I understand it, it's coming back, isn't it? It's in the autumn.
Yes, with a new companion, Bonnie Langford, and it's going back to its 25-minute format, but I don't suppose that makes any difference with the way you view it, because you see it all shoved together anyway, don't you?
Yes.
Oh, you don't?
So sometimes. Not here? You get half-hour episodes, you? Both. You get it every day for half an hour, and then the 1.5-hour film on the Saturday or something? Yeah.
Depends on the state.
Depends on the state, yeah. Well, the state of the film or the state of the universe?
State of confusion.
Yeah.
About the current season, they announced yesterday that the filming for the new season was going to be starting like next week.
The filming for the season is going to start next week, the lady says.
And the new companion doesn't show up till about the 8th episode.
Oh, does she not?
Perry will be in the first few stories.
Ah. Perry will be in the first few stories, and then Bonnie Langford takes over. Bonnie Langford is an extraordinary young lady. She was for years a bit of a joke in our profession, because her mother insisted that she had wore her hair in ringlets, and she had lovely bangs and she, with ribbons in her hair, and people in England went, "Ugh, we don't like that." But she is a knockout performer.
You're going to absolutely adore her.
She's
also been very experienced in the light entertainment field, as John is, and she just adores this.
She's
kind
a superb
of...
dancer. She won't be doing that in Doctor Who. She wants to break away and doing something different. She's a very fine singer. She's played the lead in Cats in London. She played the first really big break she got was in Gone with the Wind, a musical that she played the little girl in it. And then she did a... Yeah, have you ever heard of an English series of children's stories called Just William? Yeah. Have you? Yeah. Well, she played that horrible little girl. What was the girl called? Beth or something. Awful. Elizabeth Thumb, and they had terrible lisp, the poor father is. She was awful. And she was so good at being awful that she kept her hair in bangs up until only just recently. But she's a great performer, and she'll be very good. Yes, sir. What do we think of American TV, like Miami Vice?
Well, that's difficult to say. I mean, I don't think anybody does cop series the way Americans do. I mean, what's that, Hill Street?
Hill Street Blues.
It's just wonderfully done. As far as the others go, I'm not so keen myself. I spent my whole time telling my son that he can't have guns and he can't, you know, and consequently he's absolutely obsessed with them. Which means that every time we see it on television, there he is glued, you know, 2 inches away, collecting all the radioactivity and doing everything that I don't want him to. So I would like to see less violence on television unless it's for a political point. However, they're compelling watching, they're escapist viewing, and, you know, done very, very well. But Hill Street Blues, I think, is just the most wonderful thing. It really makes its point and is acted beautifully and shot beautifully, and just everything about it's great.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I'm going to say the same thing. It's quite my favourite programme. Taxi, I think, is superb.
Can I just add that of all the favourite programmes I've ever had to watch is Soap. I just...
Well, you see, this was a great, great revelation for us, because this was the first programme we'd ever seen in America where you really took the mickey out of yourselves. We'd never seen that before. We'd never seen that facet of your ability to do so. And now, of course, it's developed to a magnificent degree. I like Maud. I think that's a very funny program at times, but in the main, Miami Vice is marvelous entertainment, tremendous. I mean, it's escapist. entertainment, and I mean, it looks pretty with all the lovely speedboats and the white suits and things. So I must go and get a pair of those espadrilles and all that. But it's a very beautiful thing to look at. But you've got much better things. I used to think that one of the finest programs you ever made was the lovely country program. What was it called? With the farmer and his wife and the little kids. That Little House on the Prairie. Yeah. And you see, if you love Little House on the Prairie, which is quite right, because it was wonderful and absolutely marvellous and very touching, then you'd love Wurzel Gummidge. And it amazes me that people don't see that they're so terribly alike. Oh, as for this accent thing, of course, it's ridiculous, because Wurzel talks like that and he says, "I'll ask you." Well, in American, you say ask. We don't say, Wurzel doesn't say, "I'll ask you." People say, what do you say? But in fact, the West Country voice, which is what Wurzel is where the Plymouth Brothers came from, of course, and that's where the American accent came from. You probably didn't know that. That's where the A comes from, the ask, the different vowel sounds. Because in the West Country, everybody virtually speaks all their vowels with an American accent, including the R's. O-R. Yes. Can we tell us more about our children?
Well, they're monsters.
Speak for yourself. Mine's an angel.
I have a 3.5-year-old who's half black, half white, who's an angel in company and a devil in private. I have a 1.5-year-old who's half white South African. They're different fathers. My father tells me I'm doing my bit for the United Nations. When I went to Mexico, I was actually pregnant. He said, "Thank goodness you were pregnant when you went there." After the second one was born, he said, "You're going off to China next, perhaps? Australia, maybe?" So yes, I've got two of the most, the youngest is white, blonde, curly hair and huge blue eyes. And the other one is very, very dark skin and tight black curls and big brown eyes. They're just the most beautiful things in the world. They make life worth living.
How the hell do you follow that? I have two children. I have a pigeon pair, one of each. I have a boy, 21, who was a monster, and still is, but a very charming monster. He's an actor student. He's at the Bristol Old Vic Theatre School, which is about the best drama school probably in the world. I say that because it's one of the few drama schools where they actually put them out to work almost immediately. They get them in front of audiences and work in front of schools, so they get plenty of opportunity of working in front of audiences and people, which you normally don't, Rada. We never did, maybe. I am very much afraid to say that he's an extremely good actor. I'm very upset about it. Because he doesn't deserve to be, because he didn't work hard enough at being an actor, as I did. By that I mean that I used to go and see every actor going. I used to sit and stand in gallery queues and put that little canvas seat down, you know, for a shilling. You don't have that, but they used to put them outside the theatre so you could book yourself a cheap seat. And I used to see everything, and I knew everybody, and I knew who all the directors were. And my son doesn't know anybody at all. You talk about a director of a film that's won an Oscar, and he says, "Oh, who's that?" This is a rather new world of theatre. They know it their own way, and they do it their own way. And one has to admit that they seem to be doing it extremely well. He's just won an award. He's going out in front of for a big competition in Wales, an Eisteddfod, we call it. An Eisteddfod? Anybody Welsh here? And yes, yeah, you're Welsh. And in Swansea. And if he wins it, he goes to Edinburgh Festival, and he gets shown there. So it's a three-hander play, he and a black actor. And a girl comes in just at the very end, and he's wonderfully good in it. So I think he's a bit of a chip off the old family block, because we've been in the theatre for about 7 generations, both on my mother's side and on my father's side. My daughter is an artist in a way that she does. I don't know whether it's caught on in America. Do you do this interior decoration with sponges and streaking and pulling and decorating wood with marbleization and all that sort of thing?
I believe it's been called inferior desecration at times.
That's a very good name for it. Well, she does that. Hers is superior desecration. And she seems to be rather successful doing it, but she was a good artist, and so it was something for her to do apart from starving as a painter in a garret. That's the lot.
Can I just add a little sub-story to that? It's really true that you get the truth from babes and old people. I'm lying on the bed with my son one day, trying to get him off to sleep, and he's looking at my face, and he's saying, "And what's that black bit right in the middle of your eye?" This is just before I'm going up to an interview, by the way. "What's that black bit in the middle? Oh, that's the pupil, darling. And what's all that blue bit all the way around that? So that's the iris, darling. And what's that very red bit all the way around?" It's really going to give you confidence, isn't it?
My son, Sean, when I asked him when he was 8, what he wanted to be, he thought about it very, very carefully. He said, "I think I've given it a lot of thought, Papa, and I think I want to be an impersonator in the submarine." That's a hell of a profession, isn't it? I said, "I don't think there's a great deal of call for impersonators in submarines, but, you know, be the first."
Unless you're in the spy force or something. Mine wants to be a cowboy, my eldest son, so I should have brought him here.
There aren't any. Gentlemen at the end there. Yeah.
My costume. This is a question about my costume. I thought I wouldn't escape.
Is there anything that you've done? There was some sexual skill involved in it, not just with the management of the children. Has there been anything that you've done that's embarrassed you? Like Joe Grant, the actor who played Joe Grant one time, did something that embarrassed her she posed with some dollars. Have you done anything?
You want me to tell you about the skeletons in my cupboard? Yeah. Now listen, as far as the costume is concerned, this is very naive of me, I realise in retrospect. I was absolutely astounded when I turned into some kind of sex symbol. I had just no idea at all. I thought I was going into a kid's series. But I guess if you put someone in a leather leotard and put them on after the football results, the television's still on, and yeah, inevitably it happens. But I was astounded. I have done one film, a Hammer horror film, and the name of which completely escapes me, where I had my heart... torn out by the devil. I thought you were going to say something.
I was going to give him the name of the film.
I had my heart torn out by the devil, and I spent the rest of the time walking around in a white see-through nightie as a zombie. It's the coldest filming I've ever done in my life. In Dorset, in November, with nothing on, in the middle of the night, in the middle of the forest. I mean, I still got the chilblains to prove it. But never again. Sorry?
Is it available on video
cassette? It will be after today.
It did 10 days in London, then was taken off the circuit. It was that bad.
I'm interested that gentleman said something about Joe Grant, but I couldn't hear what he said. What would you repeat what you said about Joe Grant doing something revealing?
She wanted to reveal herself in a small or skinny outfit, in a pose with dollars after she left the show.
She posed in the nude, if that's what you're saying. You're very reticent, sir. Even for Georgia. I mean, Katie posed in the nude for Playboy. Is that what you mean? Then why don't you say so? Katie is a remarkable lady who's a law unto herself, and she posed in the nude. She's as blind as a bat. She can't see without her glasses. She probably hadn't got her glasses on, didn't know she hadn't got any bloody clothes on. Yeah. What's that?
Oh, what, you mean when I stripped off in that? Well, you've got a bunch of women together in a concentration camp. They're not going to walk around covering themselves up the whole time. They've only got one outfit to wear. It's got to be washed. I think when there's some kind of artistic validity attached to it, then there's no reason at all why you shouldn't take your clothes off.
Yeah, yeah.
But if it's just...
Absolutely.
But if it's just purely for, and I hope you'll pardon the pun, titillation, then I think you've got to think twice about it.
Titillation doesn't affect me.
Comment?
Oh, it affects me, I mean me personally. I'm not I don't have any problems in that respect.
I should hope not.
Yeah, yes, 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 this gentleman here.
What did you do when Wars of Gummidge wasn't on the air?
What did I do when it wasn't on the air?
Yes, when it went out of
when it went out of the window. Wurzel Gummidge went out of the window when Southern Television, as I say, lost their franchise 3 years ago, and since then I have been gainfully employed, because Wurzel, I'm happy to tell you, is a cult in England, and I do personal appearances as Wurzel. In fact, I did anybody here see him, meet him in a costume contest not very long ago? Anybody know?
Chicago.
In Chicago, that's right. Yeah. And so I do personal appearances. I'm under contract to an enormous big store called MFI in England, a furniture store. And I go around opening all their new branches. And he's very busy. But I've been working all this time to get him into production. And that's really what's been going on behind the door. Yes, I've been doing stage. I've been doing something which some of you may have heard of. Have you ever heard of a program on the Disney Channel called Super Ted? Yeah. Well, I'm the spotty man in that. Didn't you know? You never know what surprises. Yes, it's available on video cassette. Walt Disney shows it on the cable channel. It's vastly popular in America. We've sold it to 47 countries now. Unfortunately, we can't make enough of them because they take an awful long time to make. They're very beautifully made. That's why Disney bought it. He said it was the best animated series he'd seen since his father had been making them. Hanna-Barbera, now I believe, sort of joined forces with Robin Young, who makes the Super Ted series, and they're going to, I think, put out some half hours, because most of your cartoons are half hours now, aren't they? You make them into sort of specials, and they're always shown on Saturday mornings, which I think is a pity. I think I like when they were sort of split up through the week, not just have a mad bash-up of cartoons. You go dizzy with them. But anyway, that's so I was doing that on the stage this Christmas. We did an enormous production of Super Ted and the Planet of the Spooks. And with Madeleine Bell playing the Queen of the Spooks, a great black singer in England. And Victor Spinetti, who was in the series with me, and Melvin Hayes. And since then, no, apart from odd films and television and things like that, but just the fill-ins, but nothing in the way of a series, because I didn't want it to interfere with what I knew was eventually going to happen, which we'd reproduce Wurzel. Yes, for something for Louise, please. Lady there in purple.
In Tinker, I was moving, and so when I moved, I had missed the episode, and I was certain you were gone.
How did I get written out of the tank? What happened in real life was I got pregnant. And having already stated in the series that I couldn't get pregnant because my periods had stopped, they didn't feel that they could write it into the series. So they'd already written around one pregnancy to accommodate Harry. Well, then came another. I don't suppose the BBC will ever want to look at me again. What was going to be my character turned into a character called Maggie, which you'll see with the next one that's sold to you. They killed me off with Berry, unfortunately. I was very sad to leave it. It was the happiest job I ever had. And to be honest, I thought, oh my God, 2 years all women, I'm going to go bananas. I just, you know, how can I survive this? But we had such a laugh. I mean, it was like working with your very own support group, really. Just come in. The directors were terrified of us. The producer called all the regulars together one day. We were about 10 days into rehearsal. And they'd done some filming in Singapore, but we were just about to go into the camp, and we hadn't done any of that recording yet. And he called all the regulars over. He said, you know, the extras can go over one side, could the regulars come over? And we went over and he sat us all round and he said, would you mind terribly going home and asking permission of your husbands, lovers, living lovers, boyfriends, do you mind if you start growing the hair under your armpits and on your legs, please? And there's this very long pause. Of course we'd already started to do it anyway. I mean, really, of course we would, for the sake of art. There's this very long pause, and Jean Ann Crowley, who played one of the nurses, said, would you like a written letter of consent? And the producer takes 10 paces backwards, and every time we disagreed en masse, you could see them literally, these male directors, literally, physically, backing off across the room with these women going, no, we actually, I mean, nothing aggressive, we just en masse said, sorry, we disagree, and they go, fine, fine. Whatever you say, fine. And some directors said, you know, they were getting, there was a lot of kind of elbow digging, going, oh, those women, I bet you're having a great time. They go, no, we're not. It's terrifying. And the guy who played the commandant, Yamauchi, said it's the first war film he's been on where there wasn't a constant game of poker going. You know, more knitting patterns and recipes and let's dig these men down, really. But it was a wonderful experience and it changed my life. It really did literally change my life. Gave me courage to do things that I wouldn't have had courage to do before. I'm very grateful for that experience. The question...
Well, anybody who saw Tenko, I mean, it's not surprising that the men were terrified of him. I mean, they were the most alarming lookers on a women I've ever seen. I'd have been terrified of it myself. If I hadn't had a two-edged Japanese sword with me, I'd... Yeah. A gentleman over there on the edge. You, sir. Well, stand up. You're hiding. There you go. Oh. Is it true that I left Doctor Who because of Roger Delgado's death? No, it's not true at all. Roger Delgado was one of my very greatest friends. He was a great mate, had been for years. We did shows together, and I was going to do a big musical with him. Oh, actually, it's a rather nice story. There was a big Jewish producer in London, and I shouldn't mention his name, but you'll know who I mean in a minute. And he was going to star the late Gordon McRae, the great American musical singer, and Gloria Jeans. Have you heard of Gloria Jeans? Was a great star in American movies, singer, like Deanna Durbin. Beautiful. And Binnie Hale, who's a big Binnie Barnes, big star, again, American lady. And we were going to do this musical in London with Roger Delgado playing a villainous a sultan. And I was going to be the comic. And they completely changed all the casting, and they cast it with a Canadian singer called Lester Ferguson, who should have retired about 25 years before. And I was speaking to the producer one day, and he said, no, I think it's a very great mistake. I'm very sorry that I made an error and changed all the casting. He said, I should have kept it as it was with Gordon McRae. He said, Billy Barnes, Gloria Jeans, and yourself playing the comedian. And I said, yes, you should have done. You're quite right, you should have done. I said, because I mean, Lester Ferguson should have retired years before. I said, and who the hell is Iris Villiers? And he said, my wife. I never got word from that gentleman again, which is not very surprising. But I was that would have been a very good show with Roger Delgado. Anyway, the answer is that I left Doctor Who for two reasons. The first was that the team was breaking up. Barry Letts, the producer, who I admired enormously, was leaving. Terence Dix, the script editor, was leaving. And Roger had been killed in a car accident, very unnecessarily, by a cab driver. When he was going out to a location making a film in Turkey. And this I took very hard, but we got over it, as one does, life goes on. But I thought, this seems to be by the end of an era, but I know what I'll do. I'll go to the BBC, and I know Sean Sutton, who is the head of programs. He and I started in the business together. And I said, Sean, I think it's time that I moved on, but I said, I would be prepared to stay on if you managed a little rise, a little additional increment would not go down badly. And he said, well, like how much? And I thought, oh, that's a bit difficult. typical. My agent should have discussed that. So I just sort of threw something at him. It wasn't very much, I promise you. And he said, "We're terribly sorry that you're going to go." And that's absolutely true. I mean, this was having a cup of coffee in the canteen. I said, "But aren't you going to have a meeting? I mean, wouldn't you like to sort of get together the people that matter at the BBC and say, can we really afford to let Jon Pertwee go and get somebody else?" And he said, no, it's quite unnecessary. He said, if you want to rise, then we'll have to get somebody else. So I felt after all those years, there wasn't enough weeping and gnashing and wailing and ashes on the head. And so I thought it was time to leave. I'm happy to tell you that the BBC have treated me absolutely splendidly since. I've never worked from them from that day to this. That's extraordinary. I offered them Wurzel Gummidge and they turned it down flat, and I've never worked for the BBC since, apart from odd shows, but I've never been offered a series, and yet I worked with them for 6 years nearly, or 5 years. So that's the Beeb for you. Yes, another question. Yes. Besides Leela, who's my favourite cat? Well, how can you
ask? What a tactful gentleman.
Yes. What can I say? I mean, how can anybody stand up to Leela?
K9 had a good try.
Yeah, that must have been very embarrassing. my favourite character, I think that we've just mentioned, Roger Delgado. I think his master was wonderful. I've often mentioned this before. Roger was the bravest man I ever knew, because he was a coward. And I don't mean that derogatorily. He was terrified, absolutely terrified of doing anything that wasn't sitting in front of the fire with his carpet slippers on, having a nice brandy. That would suited him right down to the ground. That was the sort of life he liked. Feet up and then going off to Portugal, where he came from with his lovely wife, Kismet. And we go on holiday together, and this is what he liked. But he put him in the sea, like in the Sea Devils, or put him on a boat. He was absolutely petrified out of his life, but he did it. And that takes courage. So that's why I say he's the bravest man I ever knew. And a wonderful, wonderful actor. Superb to work with. So he's my favourite. Kismet.
Comparatively, or reserved.
Boring,
I was saying
boring, I'd say.
Well, I said just. huge straighter. You wait till I get back to England. I always get, just to fill people in that weren't here yesterday, I always get asked, what's the difference between American and British fans? And I always say that the Americans are lunatics. And what's more, they enjoy being told that they're lunatics. Which always gets a big laugh, a round of applause here, but it also does there as well. They like that answer. So, but it's the truth. It's much more, you show your appreciation much more readily, much more loudly than the English do. You also show your boredom much more readily, much more loudly than the English fans do. But it's the same when you're performing. Maybe 18 months ago, done a tour of Twelfth Night here, playing Viola, and it was a joy to play Shakespeare to an audience that didn't know the story. They were really surprised when a woman fell in love with a woman dressed up as a boy. If you don't know the story, this is just double Dutch. But so that aspect of performing to Americans is just wonderful, and the appreciation at the end of the show makes you just feel so loved and wanted and warm and all that. But equally, if you're, you know, it's a slightly long Shakespearean speech, you're going to find people are going, you can hear all that going on as well. You know, I've got to talk double fast here. But I think I've answered. I'm rambling on. Go on.
Well, you used a word there which I think sums it up beautifully and very succinctly, and that's love. You exude love. And male and female, it's a sort of love of warmth that is quite uncanny. This is why we keep coming back, because we need a shot of love.
And this is sort of... The English kind of riddle themselves with guilt. I know I'm I'm guilty of that. In as much as you think, oh, my God, here we are having a great time and Ethiopia's happening and da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. And that's a fact. But nevertheless, you're still free to have a good time. And it's that unashamedly exuberant attitude that is so welcoming.
Lady there with glasses.
Okay.
Yes, no, the lady there in the white jacket.
My favourite role. The favourite role that I played is Rosalind in As You Like It. I think Shakespeare had an idea of women way above and beyond his time. He really knew how to glory in that flying a fancy that Rosalind has. One I would love to have played and has escaped me is Juliet. She's long gone now. There's no way I can get away with 14 anymore. But yes, of the ones I played, Rosalind in As You... Gentlemen.
Why do you say that? I think you'd make a most beautiful Juliet.
Well, you'd make a wonderful Romeo.
You see, you notice how well we work together. I've only just sort of feed her the cue and she comes right back with the answer that I was waiting for. Yes. Well, sir, I'd be unwise to give any answer to that second or the first part of that question, but for the reason I explained earlier, if I said something untoward, it might get back to JMT, who is just about to sign a contract to invite me to join Colin Baker and Louise Jameson on doing another Doctor Who, which I would like to do. Honest with you, I haven't seen a lot of Doctor Who's since I left it because I've been too busy with Wurzel Gummidge and another series I had called Who Done It, which they tried over here in America, but you did that infuriating thing that you do in America, is you buy our best programs instead of showing them as we make them. You say, no, we'll recast the whole thing and play it with American actors and American directors and ruin. I mean, some of them you've got, I mean, are very good. I mean, like, what do you call Keep It in the Family, All in the Family? All in the Family. Well, that was a British show. And it was wonderfully funny, as it was. And, of course, Archie Bunker. I mean, see the original. You've never seen anything so superb as that. And Warren Mitchell, Till Death Us Do Part. It's a great pity, I think, that... can you imagine any more ridiculous than us taking Hill Street Blues and playing it in English? Yeah, it'd be very boring. But I haven't really seen many. The only reason why I look at them is because Colin is a great friend of mine, and so if I know Colin's on, I rush and put it on to see it. But I haven't really got an opinion of that. That one. Yes, lady there.
Can I tell you K-9 stories? Well, John Leeson, who does K-9, is one of the most adorable people I've ever had the privilege to work with. I was at a con with him recently, and because he does voiceover, a lot of the fans didn't know what he looked like, so he donned some buttons and a hat and a camera, and there was a K-9 sound-alike contest. And he lost it! For anything like that, the BBC have a very, very peculiar system whereby they hire their own props off themselves to work with in rehearsal, which means we couldn't afford to have K-9 in rehearsal. Now, here's a very important part of the script. It did actually mean I had a dog one time called Bosie that I based Leela on. Time when I could, and no dogs are allowed into the BBC, so there was a time I could snap my dog in, because while we were recording the episodes with K-9 before they came out, nobody knew that K-9 was a machine and not an actual real dog, so I managed to get Bosie in as if he was K-9. So that worked for me, but John said it was the only voiceover he's done. Consequently, because we couldn't have K-9 in rehearsal, John then went round on all fours. He said it's the only voiceover he's done where he has to take a shower afterwards. And put in for cleaning bills, because he's worn through the knees of his trousers. But the first canine we had was really rather difficult to work with because it could only go in a straight line. So here we are being attacked by a monster. Tom goes, quick, let's run! And we have to wait while K9 does a 59-point turn before we can go anywhere. So we were forever doing shots like, quick, let's run. Or we have to get, he could get into the TARDIS. That was the other thing, the first K9. So you'd see him trundle up to the TARDIS. Then they'd cut to our faces going, bloop, as he went into the TARDIS. And you'd see him inside the TARDIS. So he was really rather difficult to work with. But you did, when we were actually in the studio, John Leeson would be over one side in a box and we would have K9 to work with. And in the breaks, we'd be doing the crossword. That was a big thing on our program, to do the Times crossword. And you'd actually, because his voice came out of K9, we would end up doing the crossword with K9. We really learned to believe that this creature had a complete personality of his own. I adored working with him. It was a lot easier to work with than Tom Baker.
I had no trouble working with Tom Baker. There's a young man over there with his hand permanently up. I think he's a fascist. he's been like that for about an hour and a half. Yes, sir. Would you repeat the question? Oh, the first days of the Whomobile. Do you mean the Whomobile, or do you mean the story of the hovercraft? Both. Well, now in the Planet of the Spiders, which you may have seen, some of you, there's a very severe chase sequence, and Barry Letts suffered under a great delusion, and that is that I was a mechanical genius that could fly, drive, and steer anything that moved. I am a nutter. I do. I used to ride on the Wall of Death when I was young. Do you know what that is?
No.
Well, it's a big wooden bowl, and you ride motorcycles round and round it. And I used to do that, and I changed it slightly and had a baby Austin and put a lion in the back. So I was the only man who went round the Wall of Death with a lion in the back. He didn't have any teeth, actually. He was very old. I didn't want to be gunned to death, so we strapped his face up. Anyway, that's... Change it back. What the hell were we talking about? Oh, yeah. What was the question? The hovercraft. Oh, yes. And rang up Barry Letts, and I said, Barry, most wonderful thing. I've just been to the boat show in London. There's a little hovercraft about as big as this table. I said, it does about 50, 60 miles an hour, and it's got one engine that lifts it and one engine that pushes it with the prop. And I said, it's a marvelous little thing. He said, right, it's in the program. We'll have it in the big chase sequence of Planet of the Spiders. Great. So I said, there's only one thing I insist on, that is you give me a bit of time to learn how to drive it. And he said, right, you're on. So we went down, we were filming on location, and I said, Barry, can I, he said, not yet, I just need you for the next shot. You won't forget, no, I won't forget. He said, no, don't worry about it. An hour later, I said, Barry, could I, he said, not yet, we're just going to do this, two more shots. And this went on and on all day, and I still haven't driven the damn thing. And eventually he said, right, ready for the hovercraft shot. Now, in this shot, you come down the river and you go up the riverbank like that, and sitting, right where he's sitting, is a stuntman. It wasn't Terry Walsh, my stuntman, it was another fellow whose name, Stuart. And Stuart had to sit with his back to me. It's a tramp eating a sandwich. And then at the given moment, he goes, ah, and his eyes back. And I then come over the bank and I run right over the top of him with this hovercraft. Now, Stuart is a very brave man, but, you know, he doesn't want to do it too often. So, at the very first time, we come down, and Barry says, right, go. And I go, right like this, up, and there's a camera here, and there's a camera there, with a crew of about eight on each camera, and I go, this, and the wind, I'm making plenty of wind myself. I've got one on, you know, one at the back there, and there's a very big wind blowing down the River Severn, and the hovercraft goes completely out of control and goes, this, it goes, completely wipes up the camera crew. Everybody went, Barry Letts, the producer, everybody went, and They were hit with this thing. It's like a rubber Zodiac bone, you see. And so I said, I'm terribly sorry. And they said... And Barry said, well, I mean, for God's sake, I mean, can't you drive the thing? I said, no. But it's not surprising. You've never let me drive it. And I'm asking you all day whether I can drive it. And he said, oh, well, go on, have another shot. So I... So the Chris Doddidge, on the assistant director, said, right, everybody over to this side by this camera, everybody clear, out of the way, because the wind's coming down this way, and just have the two cameras going, and are you all right? He said to the stunt man, he said, well, yeah. So I come down the river, and the wind's blowing, and listen, I thought, no, I've got to allow for this wind this time. So I cut it very tight, went, and I wiped up this camera. Now, of course, this time I wiped up many more people, but they'd all left. They'd all gone over there, so they were bowling around like ninepins. I mean, and it was very, very tricky business, because they were propellers, you know, going, rushing around. I mean, it could have decapitated anybody. But this time, poor Stuart saying, look, are you going to do this or not? I'm beginning to get a bit worried about this. So I said, you'll be all right, Stuart, don't worry. So the next time, he said, nobody, no crew at all, just one operator on the camera. So everybody was up trees. Right, action, he said, right. This time I've just timed it right. And I go straight over the top of Stuart, who just lies back in time. I go over the top like that, and Barry yells, cut! Cut? I didn't know how to stop the damn thing. Now, if you ever drive a hovercraft, I mean, they just, you know, they're on a cushion of air, they keep going, and there is no brake. You can't go. So I was feeling around for brakes, there was nothing, there's no reverse prop, nothing, and there's a fin in the back, so I started going round in circles. I disappeared about 3 miles down this field, eventually finished up in a hedge. And Barry was saying, bring it back, he hasn't. You must be joking, bring it back, it's a miracle I got it there at all. Anyway, so came lunchtime, and I said in front of everybody, Barry, you've driven a lot of things in your time, haven't you? Barry said, yeah. And I said, well, why don't you have a little, don't you think he should have a little trot in it? I said, you know. So everybody said, yeah, go on, Barry, go on, Guff, yeah, have a go. And Barry said, no. He said, yes. Said I. So we put him in the hovercraft. And we pushed him out to sea. We said, press the button, Barry, and if the self-starters will start the engine, yes, you lift and you're 4-1. He went up and down the River Severn for 2 hours and 20 minutes. He could not get it on the shore. There was absolutely no way. He went up and down, going, where are we going? Yes, sir.
Okay, the person that runs the series is John Nettles. I've done 7 out of 10, and I'm just about to do 9 out of 9. They bumped me up, which is quite nice. But all I ever get to do is say, what is it, Jim, instead of what is it, Doctor? Because I'm to represent, he's the whole action life, and I'm just his private life, really. It is one of the most popular series on British television at the moment, I think primarily because it's all on film, because John Nettles is gorgeous. And all I have candlelit dinners with him as he pours out his problems, and I go to bed with him occasionally. He's terribly shy, he keeps his trousers on the whole time. In the film! But of course! So I guess I'm the envy of about 75% of the British population, of women, at the moment. So... that's my story. Yes, I've got another nine to record this year.
I would like to say it is an absolutely wonderful series, and I hope you'll enjoy it. And Louise is terribly lucky not only to be playing with probably one of the best-looking leading men in the business, but also to be making it on the island of Jersey, which is in the Channel Islands. This is a strange little place. It's a part of the United Kingdom, but they speak half French and half English in one sentence. They say, All right, the Sea of Potential Wantedine, maybe. Yeah, I mean, it's the most extraordinary. And they, but the food is wonderful. The shellfish and the lobster is marvellous. It is populated entirely by multimillionaires. Have you had any luck in that respect?
I have such a hard time, I really do. It's a tiny little island, 9 by 12, and it's a big tax dodge. The whole island is one big tax dodge. It's the most extraordinary place I've ever been to.
You have to have 250,000 a year income or something.
You have to have a turnover of 100,000 plus, you know, a million in the bank already before they'll even
before
let
you in. You can't even go and buy a house.
Except for BBC, we sign a special little bit of paper because BBC don't pay anything like that kind of money.
But it's very beautiful, and the other islands surrounding it are lovely, Guernsey and Sark and so on.
There's very recently been a most marvellous series. Have you seen any of Mr. Pye?
Yes.
Which is filmed on Sark, which is a tiny, tiny island very near Jersey, which allows no motor cars anywhere. It's just beautiful. And when the BBC went over there with their crew, they were allowed the cars. They finally had a big debate. They were allowed the cars. This island's about 4 square miles. But they had to be pulled by horses. So there's this whole crew used to saying, you've got to get there in 5 minutes. You had to wait half an hour to get across the island. And these cars, kind of for any kind of tracking shot, these cars pulled by horses. They're just pulling their hair out of the route, trying to get anything done at speed. But I do hope it's sold here. It's the most beautiful story.
This is an extraordinary little island. It was run in a feudal way completely. Put your hand down, so I'll be about an hour and a half. It was run in a sort of feudal state by a lady who was known as the Dam of Sark, and she was a ruler, and what she said went, and no way would they have any engines. Tractors were allowed. They have four farm tractors, which they're allowed. But when I first went there, many, many years ago, when I was working my first job in a repertory company in Jersey at the Springfield Theatre before the last war, I went across to see the Dam of Sark, and you never believe it, but you know what used to take us up the hill from the port there? An elephant. The only transport she had then, that was before they hadn't even got tractors, she had a big African elephant. And when you went down and you went to this little tiny island, you thought, what the hell's that? And there was this elephant with a mahout sitting on it, and you went up, and they took you up this hill. It's very steep, you know, this hill is. And the rest of the time, the old lady herself used to go around in a sedan chair. And it was literally carried around in a sedan chair by her feudal workers. They adored her. And now she's dead, and the young son is running it, and he's just allowing, I think they've got electricity now. But
didn't it come in the last 24 months or something? Yes, electricity's only just got to Sark.
Yes. I have a reputation of being a scavenger. I think he means a thief. How much stuff did I get? A hell of a lot. What I did, I collected because my son, Sean, had a museum of sort of Doctor Who memorabilia. And at the end of a series, if people didn't want things, I used to say, you know, do you want that prop or something? They'd say, no, go on over, sir, give it to Sean. So I had a pretty big one, collection. I had the Metabilis crystal I took home. That was unfortunate because they needed it for another series. And Barry Lett said, where's the Metabilis crystal? Ah, they said, ah. I'm afraid we haven't got the Metabilis crystal. And Barry said, yeah, I know who's got it. So they said, yes. So Barry got on the phone and said, John, the Metabilis crystal. And I said, And he said, have you got it? I said, no. He said, did you have it? And I said, yes. What did you do with it? I said, I gave it to my son. And Barry said, what did he do with it? And I said, sold it. So we then had to find out who it was that Sean had sold it to, and I had to go pay it back, give him the money back, and we actually got the Metabilis crystal, which when you see it, you will see the big Metabilis crystal that appeared in the Planet of the Spiders, I think, wasn't it? Yeah, or the Green Death, one of those. I had a lot of other things too, but you've heard about those. I'll tell about those tomorrow. Yes, sir.
A related question. When you did the House That Drew Blood, there was that gorgeous picture of you that hung over the mantel in the ruffled shirt, the velvet jacket, and all.
You're quite right, madam, I did, yes. It was so big that it hung in the garage. Ingeborg, my wife, said, I can't stand that painting. It was a painting that hung of me over the fireplace in a film. Who hands up anybody who's seen a film of Michael, The House That Drip Blood? Oh, quite a few.
Which
is available on video. It's available on video. And there was this big portrait which hung over the mantelpiece, yes. I was given that to take home, but it was in the house for a time, but then Inga said, I can't stand that any longer. Take it away. So it hung in the garage, and now my handyman's got it with great pride in his house in Orpington. Yes, sir?
Okay, you talked about British and American fans. Have you ever traveled and met any fans in other nationalities, like Japan or...
Yeah, Japanese fans are absolutely superb. The only trouble is I can't understand what they're saying. They may be saying they hate us, but I don't think they do. They shout and cheer a great deal. They like science fiction enormously, of course. But the fans that we do have, which are very vociferous indeed, of course, are the Australians. The Australians are probably, next to you, the biggest collection of fans anywhere in the world. And they are very spread out, but they're much more, not by distances. I mean, you're spread out from greater distances, but you've got a lot of things in between, if you follow what I mean. You've got Macon and you've got Atlanta, not very far away in Australia. It's not like that. You know, you've got Adelaide and you go thousands of miles away to get to the next big city. So when they have conferences, it's very difficult for them to get about. It's a hell of a way for them to travel and to go. So this is why we don't go. And we haven't been yet, have we? But I think there's talk of one.
There has been one con, which I believe...
Did Peter went to?
Yes.
Yeah, Peter Davison went to one, but I think that was arranged anyway and Peter just happened to be there.
And also Janet Fielding's hometown or something.
Oh, that would be it.
That's how they got it together. The fandom is just starting to connect itself with each other in Australia. Yes, there's a conference underway. I would just like to write just one thing about the little local fan groups. I recently done a con in Leeds in England, Northern England, and this was just three teenage lads got it together to do something, and all the proceeds went to Ethiopia. As a result of that, the hotel gave a cut price, the fans gave exceedingly generously, and out of just one day, we raised between us £1,700. And that, if that can be followed here, if somehow or other you could just go back to your little local town and maybe just get just one celebrity over. Don't go for a whole mass, because as soon as people realise what the cause is for, it opens up their generosity and therefore opens up their purse strings. So I would just, if any of you are contemplating doing a con and can't afford it, then make the proceeds for something like Ethiopia or the third world countries, and you'll be very surprised, I think, at the response of people's generosity and the number of people and celebrities that will be prepared to come for expenses only.
One thing I'd like to say, every conference that I go to, I always bring an article of apparel. Naturally, I bring several articles. But a specific article of apparel that's been worn in Doctor Who. I'm practically out of my original waistcoats, which you call vests, because I always wore waistcoats with them. But I have brought one with me here, which is an orange one with an orange jacket that I wore with a high collar. I don't remember which particular series it was. And I work for muscular dystrophy in England. And if anybody wants to put in a bid for it, just write their name down and the offer that they're making for this waistcoat, and give it to any member of the B team or any member of the staff, and they will hand it up to me, and whoever is the highest bidder at the end of the conference will get the vest. And it was worn in Doctor Who. I can find out for you which particular one it was. You'll probably know it better than I. There was one other thing I wanted to say to you. No, there wasn't. We've got 3 or 4 minutes. Yes, great. Yes, the gentleman there on the end. And behind you, you have one.
Yes, after you finish this report with you, finish Doctor Who, were you afraid of being typecast by the public for your characters?
Were we afraid of being typecast?
There aren't that many savages going. I tell you what I was afraid of for the first time ever, was being out of work. The BBC is kind of law unto itself, and therefore a cocoon when you're working there. I mean, they buy your soul. We were on a 9-day turnaround, doing 50 minutes worth of filming every 9 days, which is a really tight work. And you forget that there's a world outside there. So for the first time ever, I was scared of being out of work. Luckily, it didn't happen. I went straight down to Bislovik and played Portia in Merchant of Venice, so and got my jab of live contact with the audience. It's a bit like a drug. I need it from time to time really badly. So, but no, I wasn't afraid of being typecast. I've tried very, very hard to mix my medias that I work in, and also mix the kind of varied parts that I play. So if I'd stayed any longer, I think the fear would have grown with that. I do think there's a big danger of staying with something too long.
Yes, it's usually people who are typecast and have the problem are young actors or character actor that has come from obscurity, never been seen before on television. He goes into a series and he runs in it for maybe 3 years, 4 years. And very often when this happens, when they come out, they find themselves completely out of work because nobody will see them as anything else but that character that they've been. I'm so long in the tooth, and I've been in this business for so long in so many facets that, as I say, starting in, I was a straight actor, I was in Shakespeare, I was at RADA, I did all my repertory work and straight theatre in the West End. And then after the war, I was in on the music halls and so on. I've worked in every medium, and therefore you don't get really typecast. People know me for so many different facets of show business. But it's those that are not known beforehand, whose faces are not familiar beforehand, that do have that terrible problem, and they do get typecast very much so. Luckily, it didn't happen with me. I went straight from Doctor Who into a quiz series called Who Done It. I think there was a belief that it was Doctor Who done it. I think they thought there was a connection there somewhere. And from that into Wurzel. And of course, there's no connection between Wurzel Gummidge and the dandy of Doctor Who. Yes, sir, with a camera.
What is the greatest compliment or the most gracious compliment that you've ever received? Both.
Louise?
One I can repeat, you mean?
Yeah.
I did a play called The Relapse. And for that I received a crit. It was a tour with the Cambridge Theatre Company that said I was the next Vanessa Redgrave, and I already said earlier how much I liked that. Also, but it was the most glowing crit that I think I've ever read, anyway. However, for the same performance, in the same town, in a different newspaper, I got a crit that said, how can the actor acting opposite this woman cope with such an appalling performance? Oh. So drastically miscast. And it just actually knocked compliments in print into the right perspective, that you can, for the same performance from two different people, receive the most marvellous crit and the most appalling one at the same time. But I guess that was the most marvellous thing, but there was the flip side to the coin.
With me, the answer is when I was thrown out of RADA for being incompetent. I was doing a play and they invited the late Noel Coward to come and see it. And in all plays, when you're a student, you never play the same role right the way through. You play it for maybe one scene and then another actor plays that scene and another girl plays that girl. But I was lucky because I played in the first act the man who was murdered. And in the last act, with the aid of a raincoat, battered hat, and a ginger moustache, I played the detective who found out who murdered me. Now, remember that I had been fired for inefficiency and hopelessness and no future in the theatre at all. And when the show was over, we were all lined up backstage, and Noel Coward came round, and Sir Kenneth Barnes, who was the head of the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts, said, "Now, Mr. Coward, was there anybody that you particularly enjoyed?" And Noel Coward said, "Yes, it was a very, very good, charming performance by a very talented young lady, who's Joan Greenwood, who's one of our great actresses, character actresses." And he said, "There were two remarkably good performances by two young actors. I don't know who they are. One who played the man who was murdered in the first act, the fellow who was the detective who found out who murdered him in the last." gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for your attention. 2 hours has flown by. We're very sorry, but we've got to wrap it up there. But I shall look forward very much to seeing you tomorrow. And if anybody, incidentally, is interested in my life, I have with me copies of my autobiography, and I'm only too pleased and happy to sell them to you and assign them for you in the dealer's room. Thank you very much indeed.